this is going to be two firsts for PHP Southwest. The first first is apparently a one-slide talk. And the second first is that it's going to be storytelling, which is why I have paper instead of just looking at slides and talking like everyone else has done so fantastically today. So I interviewed a bunch of people to research this, and I asked them all about the worst technical tests that they'd ever had. This is the outcome, and I've condensed them and turned them into fables. Full disclosure, I've had to merge some and abbreviate them because there were so many that I've only been able to tell about a third of the ones that I've been told. I've changed all of the company names, and instead of people, there are animals, because it's going to be traditional fables, moral of the story, not always at the end. But yeah, I hope you enjoy. So the first story is about the cat. The cat applied for a senior position. Cat took examples of her work to her interview with Dog and talked about the problems that she had solved, the architectural decisions she had made, and so on. After an hour, the dog said, "That was all very well, but here's your test. It will take an hour." This test was a simple one-field select statement, much simpler than any of the example queries that she had already talked through. Instead of building the select statement, she decided to utilize the time wisely, and she turned the database structure from second normal form into sixth normal form and suggested a whole horde of optimizations. Dog offered the cat the job on the spot, but the cat turned it down. The moral of the story is that you should do your technical tests at a level appropriate for the role in question. If your test represents your role, well, this role would have wasted a lot of the cat's talents and skills and time. Our second story is about the hippo. Hippo went for an interview at Snobware. Snobware gave Hippo a multiple choice test. Hippo's exact words to me when I interviewed him were, "You can only get through this test if you swallow a manual first." The problem was, Hippo was expected to know all of this stuff that you always know exists, but you always look up, as well as lots of niche knowledge and stuff that's really weird about specific applications. And it turns out that actually, no one ever got more than 40% in this exam. The moral of the story number one is don't test someone's memory when you actually meant to test something else, like whether they can code. The test also asks you to write out Vim commands, which is kind of weird. Moral of the story number two, don't test if someone uses the same tools as you when you actually meant to test something else, like whether they can code. So Hippo was curious. He asked, "Do you all use Vim? Do you not use anything like perhaps text edit?" This was quite a few years ago. The developers at Snobware said, "We're purists. Vim is the best and only option. No one here would ever use anything else." To this day, Hippo is unfortunately suspicious of any Vim user, which is an indictment on Snobware, not on Vim. So the third moral of this story is, don't dismiss the ways other people are comfortable coding, because if the outcome is still good, it's mean, and you might end up excluding some really awesome candidates. So the next story is about Sparrow. Sparrow applied to CodeNest for a role doing JavaScript. Sparrow's interviewer, Hawk, asked him to write on paper a simple piece of code to loop over an array of objects and extract a property. Easy. In C. Apparently, the systems that CodeNest built used to be written in C. Actually, they were still written in C, but this was mentioned nowhere in the job description, the JavaScript job description. So Sparrow said, "I don't know any C. I can learn it, and I can answer all of these questions easily now, in JavaScript, or later, in C." But Hawk just sheepishly sent Sparrow on his way. Sparrow was disappointed, and he was disappointed that he was not given the opportunity to do something that he could have accomplished. So the first moral of the story is obviously that your tech tests and your advertised roles need to line up. The second moral of the story is that if you don't need someone with deep experience in a specific tool or language, it's likely that testing their general coding ability or their ability to learn a language or framework or tool could open the door to many more fantastic, phenomenal candidates. So the fourth story is about a gecko. Now, Cool Company Limited told Gecko that they were going to give him a phone interview, and they promised that there would be no tech test. So Rat and Mouse, the interviewers, sat in a room, they rang up Gecko, and Mouse chatted with him for half an hour or so. Rat said nothing. Finally, Mouse asked Rat if he had any questions for Gecko. So Rat mulled it over, and eventually he fired off a problem-solving question, probably off the top of his head. The question was about figuring out a binary search, and it's called the two-egg problem. Gecko was totally thrown, but after a bit of stuttering and muttering, he got the answer. So the first moral of this story is that you shouldn't do things that you said that you're not going to do, because if you do, it's not fair, and it reflects badly on how you're going to treat your developers when they finally are involved in real projects with you. So Mouse whispered to Rat, "Is he right?" And Rat said, "No." So Mouse asked, "Is he close?" And Rat said, "No." The second moral of the story is don't talk about your developers as if they're not there in the room with you. It's rude, and it shows that you don't respect them. But worse, Rat had had the wrong answer all along, and Gecko was right. Awkwardly, they spent the rest of the interview figuring that out. So the final moral of that story is that you should prepare before you give a technical test. Don't ask questions that you don't know the answer to. That should be obvious. Finally, Frog was left in a room with a laptop, a build, and a list of features for her to add. Frog spent half an hour of the test just hoping that her CSS fixes were working because she had never used a Mac before and didn't know how to refresh the browser. So the moral of that story is check that people know how to use the skills that you give them to complete the tools that you give them to complete the test, because otherwise it's an unfair test of their skills. But Turtle is the reason that I wrote this talk at all. Turtle was sent a tech spec by the Doodaroo brothers. It was really confusing, so Turtle asked his friends, Bunny, Snail, and me, to take a look at these documents from the Doodaroo brothers. Each of us came up with two or more totally different interpretations of the spec, which is ridiculous. In fact, we were so baffled that we asked all of our friends. We even asked the senior developers in the PHP elephant herd, and none of them knew. So Turtle emailed the Doodaroo brothers, who said, well, if you can't figure it out, then maybe you're just not qualified for the job. Which meant, by extension, that unbeknownst to Doodaroo brothers, Bunny, Snail, the PHP elephants, me, and all of our friends apparently weren't qualified for this junior position. The moral of that story is that you should always be open to questions and listen to your candidates because they might have valid concerns or feedback for you and your processes. So that's all great, but how do you give a good technical test? I'm slightly tight on time, so I'm only going to tell you a few examples. Firstly, give your candidates as much free rein as possible, as much free rein as the role allows. So an example of this would be to avoid prescribing frameworks and libraries so that you have a fair example of someone's ability to complete your task in a manner of their choosing. But if you do prescribe something, remember that if they haven't used it, you are testing their ability to learn it. So if they've never used something before and they do okay, then they'll probably be fantastic once they've worked in it for a couple of months. Secondly, a really simple improvement that can really revolutionize your processes just because everyone will be so much more comfortable is to make it super clear whether or not people can use the internet to check the docs while they work. Of course, everyone feels bad when they Google something in an interview, but in reality, everyone checks the docs for certain things. Make those expectations clear and tell them something like, do it how you would normally do it. And if you don't let them do that, then have a good reason, because they shouldn't be just tested on their memory rather than their ability to code. You should also make the test as representative of what they'll do in their job as possible. So if they're likely to be communicating with other developers, build in some fair programming. And if your company is never going to use a tool, don't test them on it. But most importantly, always give good feedback. Thanks.